Hi friends, welcome to NEO IAS daily current affairs session. Today, the 17th of November, we are going to discuss these topics. They are autoimmune diseases, Ranganathittu bird sanctuary, OBOR and ACT East, Bernard Star B, kilogram, and then our daily sessions of MAP aided program and PQRS. So we'll see the topics one by one. First of all, let's begin with autoimmune diseases. So autoimmune diseases came into the news because researchers found that a class of immune cells also triggers obsessive compulsive behavior in patients suffering from autoimmune disorders. To understand this better, we should know what autoimmune disorders and obsessive compulsive disorders mean. An autoimmune disease is a condition arising from an abnormal immune response to a normal body part. In this condition, a body's immune system goes rogue and attacks healthy cells. There are at least 80 types of autoimmune diseases, and nearly any body part can be involved. The cause is generally unknown. However, in some cases, it was found hereditary, while others triggered by infection or other environmental factors. And some common diseases that are generally considered autoimmune, it includes a celiac disease, diabetes type 1, then inflammatory bowel disease, multiple sclerosis, psoriasis, and rheumatoid arthritis. Now, many of us might have come across the term OCD or obsessive compulsive disorder, but may not know what it is actually. So, as you can see, OCD is a common, chronic, and long-lasting disorder in which a person has uncontrollable or recurring thoughts and behaviors that he or she feels the urge to repeat over and over. A most common example would be checking something again and again, even when you have done it already, like checking whether you locked doors or switched off lights, etc. So that is OCD. And researchers now have found that in persons who have autoimmune diseases, a particular class of immune cells, which is called the Th17 lymphocytes, it can also induce OCD in those patients. So that's all about the autoimmune diseases. Now we will move on to the second topic of the day, that is Ranganathittu Bird Sanctuary. The Ranganathittu Sanctuary authorities have decided to file cases against visitors who are caught vandalizing the trees and the bamboo by engraving or scratching on them. Etching on trees will disturb the birds besides damaging the beauty of the sanctuary. Now, regarding more details about the sanctuary, it is the largest bird sanctuary of Karnataka in the Mandya district. And it comprises 6 islets on the banks of Kaveri River, which forms an important nesting ground for birds. So, Kaveri River must be noted with importance. And also, during winter months, as many as 40,000 birds congregate in the sanctuary from Siberia, Latin America, and parts of North India. Now, please refer to the question. It was asked in 2013. As you can see here, consider the following pairs: Corbett National Park, Ganga; Kaziranga National Park, Manas; and Silent Valley National Park, Kaveri. Which of the above pairs are correctly matched? And you can see the options here. That is why I said Kaveri must be noted and questions like this could be asked. Now, coming back to the question, Ramganga River and Corbett National Park is a very basic fact. And even for a brief period from 1954 to 57, the Corbett National Park was called as Ramganga National Park. So, that shows the significance of the river, and therefore the first pair is wrong, and so we can strike off both options A and C, because both options A and C contains the first statement or the first pair. So that goes wrong. Now B is 3 only, and the pair 3 is Silent Valley and Kaveri. Silent Valley National Park is very famous and the river flowing through it is Kuntipura. So we are left with option D, that is none is correctly matched. So, I just mentioned the question for your knowledge. The next topic is OBOR and ACT East. The Chinese ambassador to India stated that India's ACT East policy and China's OBOR both are natural areas of cooperation. Now, we'll see OBOR and ACT East in detail and how they could be asked for UPSC. The OBOR, the Belt and Road Initiative, also known as the One Belt, One Road or the Silk Road Economic Belt, and the 21st Century Maritime Silk Road. It is a development strategy adopted by the Chinese government and which involves infrastructure development and investments in countries in Europe, Asia and Africa. In this, belt refers to the overland routes or the Silk Road economic belt, whereas the road refers to the sea routes or the 21st century maritime Silk Road. And until 2016, the initiative was officially known in English as the One Belt and One Road Initiative. And this was initially announced in the year 2013 with a purpose of restoring the ancient Silk Road that connected Asia and Europe. But now, the project scope has been expanded over the years to include new territories and development initiatives. UPSC asked Belt and Road Initiative in 2016. We'll just have a look on the question. You can see here. The Belt and Road Initiative is sometimes mentioned in the news in the context of the affairs of A. African Union, B. Brazil, C. European Union and D. China. And I hope now all of you would be knowing the answer. Now, to explain the ACTist policy, it is a new version of the Lookist policy of India. It is actually an effort to cultivate extensive economic strategic relations with the nations of Southeast Asia. That is why it is said Look East or Act East. Now we will move on to our next topic, Bernard Star B. Astronomers have discovered a frozen planet with a mass of over 3 times that of the Earth and orbiting the closest star to the Sun. And that is the Bernard Star B. The Bernard Star B is potentially a rocky planet and it is considered as super Earth. Bernard Star is the next closest star to the Sun after the Alpha Centauri triple system. The star is a type of faint low mass star called a red dwarf. So what is a red dwarf? A red dwarf or M dwarf, it is a small and a cool star. Red dwarfs are by far the most common type of stars in the Milky Way, at least in the neighborhood of the Sun. But because of their low luminosity, individual red dwarfs, it cannot be easily observed. And from Earth, not even one is visible to the naked eye. And Proxima Centauri, the nearest star to the Sun, it is actually a red dwarf. So that's all regarding the topic. Now, the next topic is kilogram. The International System of Measurements has redefined the kilogram and other key units. And what are those key units? We'll see. The kilogram for mass, the Kelvin for temperature, the ampere for electrical current and the mole for amount of substance. They all were redefined. Until now, the kilogram has been defined as the mass of a platinum iridium lump or the so-called Grand K, which is kept in a secured vault on the outskirts of Paris. It has been the world's one true kilo, against which all others were measured since 1889. But now, it's being retired and replaced by a new definition based on a scientific formula. The scientific formula definition is based on Planck's constant. The new formula-based definition of the kilogram, it will have multiple advantages over the precision-crafted metal lamp that has set the standard for more than a century. Among the advantages, the important one is that, unlike a physical object, the formula cannot pick up particles of dust or decay with time or be dropped and damaged. It is also expected to be more accurate when measuring very small or very large masses. And finally, it spares nations the need to occasionally send their kilos back to France for calibration against the Grand K. And now since we have mentioned the International System of Measurements, we'll just have a look at what are the details about the International System of Measurements. In 1874, the British Association for the Advancement of Science, or simply the BAAS, they introduced the CGS, that means the centimeter gram second system of measurements. And in 1889, the system transitioned under the General Convention of Weights and Measures to have new base units of meter, kilogram and second. That means from centimeter gram second to meter, kilogram and second. New base units such as the ampere for electrical current, as I mentioned, the Kelvin for temperature, the candela for luminous intensity and the mole for amount of substance, they were all later additions. And this was later renamed as the International System of Measurement or the present SI as we all know in 1960. Now, regarding the International Bureau of Weights and Measures, it is an intergovernmental organization that was established by the Meter Convention. That should be noted. The BIPM was established by the Meter Convention through which member states act together on matters related to science and measurement standards. The organization is usually referred by its French initialism, that means BIPM. The BIPM's headquarters is based at Sèvres in France, and it also has the custody of the international prototype of the kilogram, which we were discussing earlier. So, that's all regarding the news pieces for today. Now, we will move on to our daily session of MAP-aided program. For that, we have Samoa. Samoa is a country comprising the westernmost group of the Samoan Islands in Polynesia. The two main islands in Samoa are Savai and Upolu, and it is a member of the Commonwealth of Nations. Also, it was the first Pacific island country to attain independence, and you can refer the map, and this is a country which lies within the area of the Ring of Fire. So, since we have mentioned the Ring of Fire, we'll just have some information about the same. The Ring of Fire is a major area in the basin of the Pacific Ocean where many earthquakes and volcanic eruptions occur. Please see the diagram for clarity. In a large 40,000 kilometer horseshoe shape, you can see the shape of Ring of Fire. It is a horseshoe shape. It is associated with a nearly continuous series of oceanic trenches, volcanic arcs and volcanic belts, and even plate movements. Also, it has 452 volcanoes, which means that more than 75% of the world's active and both active and dormant volcanoes, they belong to this region. And the Ring of Fire is sometimes called as the Circumpacific Belt also. Now, we have mentioned Samoa as a part of Polynesia. So, what is Polynesia? Polynesia is a sub-region of Oceania, which is made up of more than 1,000 islands scattered over the central and southern Pacific Ocean. The indigenous people who inhabit the islands of Polynesia, they are termed as Polynesians. And they share many similar traits including language, family, culture and beliefs. Historically, they had a strong tradition of sailing and using stars to navigate at night. And the largest country in Polynesia is New Zealand. Now, you can see in the diagram, there are three major cultural areas in the Pacific. They are Melanesia, Micronesia and Polynesia. You can see right here. Micronesia, as the name itself says, is micro or made up of small islands. And Polynesia has many islands. Poly means many and it has many islands. So, that's all regarding the MAP-aided program. And next, we'll move on to our final session of PQRS. For that, the question for today is, you can see here from environment. The question is, the acidification of oceans is increasing. Why is this phenomena a cause of concern? There are four statements. I'll read the statements one by one. The first statement says, the growth and survival of calcareous phytoplankton will be adversely affected. The second statement says, the growth and survival of coral reefs will be adversely affected. The third statement is, the survival of some animals that have phytoplanktonic larvae, it will be adversely affected. The fourth statement is, the cloud seeding and formation of clouds will be adversely affected. And which of the statements are correct? And you can see the options here. So, we'll discuss the question. It's about ocean acidification. So, what is ocean acidification? Ocean acidification is the decrease in the pH of Earth's oceans, and this is caused by the uptake of carbon dioxide. And about a quarter of carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, it goes straight into the ocean where it forms carbonic acid. And ocean acidification of course has negative consequences upon calcifying organisms, and this calcifying organisms include corals, crustaceans, mollusks, etc. And under normal circumstances, the calcite and aragonite are stable in ocean waters. However, when the pH decreases, as mentioned in the question, when the pH decreases, the concentration of these ions, it also decreases, and hence the calcium carbonate structure becomes vulnerable to dissolution. So, from this, we can understand that statements 1 and statement 2, they both are correct. Also, apart from calcification, organisms may suffer other adverse effects through negative impacts on food resources. It may even force some organisms to reallocate resources away from productive endpoints. So, that means the third statement is also true. And now regarding the fourth statement, ocean acidification doesn't have any impact on cloud seeding. So, the answer is 1, 2 and 3 only, that is option A. And that's all for today. Thank you so much for listening.